I'm glad you're on your toes. It is indeed May 19th, much as, in fact, I'm really glad it is. Anyway, first we will review the minutes of the April 21st meeting, which is what I was looking at. Do we have any comments on the minutes or changes?
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Page 2, under Highland Subdivision, it reads, a request by Peter D. Kennedy of Greater Portland Development Group for an extension of the letter of credit. I think what we're voting on, or the order before us, was an extension of the deadline for submission of the letter of credit. Isn't that right?
That's right.
At the time?
Maureen?
What you were voting on is the deadline for submitting a letter of credit under that approved amount. There wasn't a deadline for submitting a letter of credit, but that amount that you reviewed has a time limit on it.
Okay, so it does read correctly. I'm in error.
Well, I seem to have lost my minutes here. Were there any other comments on the minutes? I had one correction. If I could just look, I could pick it right up for you. I think it was on page 3. On page 3, Mr. Parkhurst returned to his seat for the remainder of the appeals. I think appeals should read meeting.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
No further comments on the meeting, on minutes of the meeting. So I hear a motion for approval.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor? Against? The minutes of the April 21st meeting are accepted as drafted and amended. We have before us tonight and received in our packet correspondence. We have a letter from Rick Weinschenk, the Conservation Commission meeting minutes, a letter from John Bates, Stonegate Homeowners Association notice, Memorandum of the Right to Know Law Summary, People's Heritage Bank dismissal notice, a letter from our town attorney on letters of credit, a letter from the town manager, Ray the Cape Woods letter of credit, and finally a letter from Allison Earnhardt. And I think that's, there's nothing else here.
I'm sure.
Yes?
I received a letter from Shaw Sprague during the past month.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you have one, a copy of that as well? It doesn't show a copy.
Yes, I've made a copy for myself.
Oh, okay.
But every member of the board received a copy of that.
Is it the same one I got?
Yep. Yours is open.
Oh, okay. I thought it was just the name. We also have before us tonight a copy of a fax received today from Monahan Leahy, Hockadell and Libby, who are our town attorneys, with respect to the Rosewood subdivision easement deeds review. A telephone memo from T.Y. Lynn International received today. A fax regarding the same thing, the Rosewood subdivision. And finally, a memorandum of the June 9th, 1992 Shoreland Zoning Workshop at the Community Center from 7 to 8:30. And I do believe that does finally complete everything. I really thought I was pulled together tonight here. It's going to go great from here on. Better. The first order of business tonight is the Tinsman Fitness Center, a request by Thomas Tinsman to extend the June meeting the site plan review of the conversion of approximately 1,000 square feet of office space to a fitness center located at 349 Ocean House Road, pursuant to Section 19-2-9 of the subdivision ordinance. Do we have anyone here from Mr. Tinsman's?
Madam Chair,
yes.
I'd like to excuse myself from deliberation on this matter for two reasons, none of which are a direct conflict of interest. However, I am serving on the Town Center Committee with Mr. Tinsman, and just recently my son has been placed on his Little League team. So, if anything...
Major that, conflict yeah, right there.
So. I would prefer not to...
That's completely understandable. Why don't we appoint Judy Lardner to vote in your place as a voting member for this? Okay. We have a letter from the applicant. I'll read it for the benefit of the audience. Dear Maureen, I've been informed by the engineer putting information together for my site plan review that he needs more time to get everything in order. Please allow me to table my review until the June 1992 Planning Board meeting. Hopefully, I'll be able to meet with you prior to the June deadline to make sure we have all the facts and plans that will be needed. Sincerely, Tom Tinsman. Is there any comment?
I guess I'd just like to ask the town planner for a quick review of are there any time deadlines ticking? I know you've told us that the we began the review 9 months ago at the October 91 meeting. We last had plans in January of 92. Are we running into anything by just continuing
under,
to extend?
Yeah, this is being reviewed under the site plan regulations, and unlike the subdivision ordinance, there aren't the same time constraints. So, no, there's nothing in the ordinance that limits you. The only thing you may want to keep in mind is whenever you have a project that is pending for a long period of time, if there are any ordinance changes that take effect after the date the application becomes pending, this application would be exempt from that. I don't believe there are any ordinance changes that would affect this.
I guess just as a matter of practicality, my inclination would be to target a year's time from the date it was approved as sort of my out date for consideration of this, and suggest that that might be the board's out date. I guess I'd hate to have it go more than 12 months for no particular reason. So I'm saying I have no objection to the extension until June, but in June, if we get another request, I'd consider putting some kind of a time deadline at that point.
Okay. In which case, do we have a motion?
I'll move that it be ordered that based on the request of the applicant for an extension of time, the request of Thomas Tinsman for site plan review of conversion of approximately 1,000 square feet of office space to a fitness center located at 349 Ocean House Road is tabled to the June 16th meeting of the Planning Board, June 16th, 1992.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed? Maureen, did you vote? Yes, okay. It's unanimous. I didn't see that. The next order of business is Highland Subdivision. Phases 1B and 2A, letter of credit. Request by Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for an extension of the letter of credit amount approved for Phase 1B and 2A of the Highland Subdivision in the amount of $193,715.20. Pursuant to Section 16-2-4, sub C, sub 7A of the subdivision ordinance. I see Mr. Kennedy. And
excuse me, as we pass, but I have to excuse myself from this item.
Okay. In which case, Tim Eichenberg will be appointed voting member for this matter.
Thank you.
Would you introduce yourself, please?
Yes, I certainly will. My name is Stephen Moore. The board of members last meeting, I was here in Mr. Kennedy's absence, and because of some concerns that the board had relative to compliance with the erosion controls, the board had requested that we come back this evening to continue the discussion about this extension. What I'd like to do is just address very quickly the concerns that the board members had. Specifically, there was a letter from the DEP regarding compliance with the erosion control standards that were made a condition of Mr. Kennedy's approval. And I believe there was also a follow-up letter from Ross Cutlitz at the Soil Conservation Service. And I have had follow-up conversations with both the Department of Environmental Protection, David Ladd, from the Enforcement Division, who was the one who had authored the letter that you had at the last meeting, as well as speaking with Ross Cutlitz relative to the erosion control work at the site. I had followed up with Peter when he got back and found out, in fact, that The majority of the work that is mentioned in Mr. Ladd's letter had been completed at the time of our meeting. I have subsequently performed two inspections out at the site and talked with both David Ladd and Ross relative to each of the issues, and would represent to you this evening that the project is in compliance. I've talked with Ernie McVane about this. His one remaining issue was the seeding of the stockpiled areas, which has been done in the time set forth in David Ladd's letter. David was unable to get out and do an inspection, but there is correspondence and some photographs that will be copied to Maureen relative to Mr. Kennedy bringing the project into compliance. I think that was the board's one major concern or issue at the last meeting with regard to the request for extension. On that matter of the extension, the bank did forward a draft copy to Mr. McGovern today in the amount of $193,000 for the project, and what we'd ask for is the motion that you had mentioned, which is another 60 days. The bank has requested a level one hazardous waste audit, and that's going to take a few days to get done. This just came up 2 days ago. So we're anticipating trying to get this wrapped up and back in, the letter of credit that is, within 2 to 3 weeks. That is our target goal.
Okay, you're looking for an extension to July 21st, 60 days from today or 60 days from your original request?
60 days from today.
Okay. And at that point, you feel within the next 3 weeks you'll have a signed letter of credit?
That's what we believe right now, pending the outcome of the hazardous waste audit.
Okay, and how long do those take?
Actual time in the field is usually about 2 to 3 days,
mm-hmm.
but total lapse time is probably about a week or two.
And do you have that already scheduled to go, or?
I'm not sure. It is scheduled, but do you know when?
Either this Friday or the beginning of next week.
For the record, Mr. Kennedy indicated sometime late this week or early next week.
Okay, yes, thank you. And you have come into compliance with your DEP conditions?
Yes.
The last item had been the seeding of the stockpiled?
That's correct.
And when was that seeded?
It was initially seeded on the 16th and then overseeded again after I had taken a look at it on the 16th. It was overseeded, I think, on the 18th?
Of May?
Yes.
A couple of days ago?
Yes.
Okay.
We're still using the pot, and we're using it actually on a daily basis.
Okay. And again, I'll enter for the record that Mr. Kennedy stated that they were using the stockpiled material on a daily basis, and it's been seeded twice this week.
Correct.
Do we have any comment from the board? Mr. Edsel, you look like you have a question.
I just have a comment. We had requested that you demonstrate compliance. I was hoping we'd see some type of letter. Is it David Ladd from compliance?
Yes, David.
Works out of South Portland?
He works out of the Kenko Road Department.
Yeah. Oh, that's right.
Yes.
I moved it. The design of the silt fence along the access road, was it designed to have a section of it missing?
No, I think the section that you're talking about that's missing is a piece that's moved periodically to allow the dozer to go in and out. But
on the south side of the road?
No. It's continuous.
Yeah, yes and a no.
On the south side of the
south
road,
side of the road,
it's designed to be continuous with a gap at that one location. When you go out in the field and you look on the south side, the silt fence runs continuous up to a point where it meets grade, and then there's an opening in it. But when I looked on Saturday, it was continuous as it was proposed on the plans.
It wasn't yesterday. I was down to the site yesterday looking around, and I certainly would rather have some type of statement from the DEP, just personally.
Does the town planner have anything to add to this with respect to compliance or?
The code enforcement officer and I went down to the site this afternoon, and it appeared that there was a significant amount of area that was exposed soil. And according to the letter that the DEP wrote, there are areas, all exposed soil was supposed to be seeded. I'm assuming that because the site is under construction that there are areas that couldn't be seeded, but we didn't see anything that was seeded. At the same time, I would like to add that the code enforcement officer and I are uncomfortable with substituting our judgment for the DEP's.
Okay. Could I ask a question back to the planner? Exactly what areas were unseeded? Because I know that Lot 2 and the farmhouse, which are disturbed, are not seeded, but they're under private control and outside of control of Mr. Kennedy's project. And I had looked at it, and in fact, some of the soil that is exposed is just the stockpile area, but other areas had been seeded.
There's also some ditches on the side of the road, which I assume are still within the right-of-way, that also should be seeded or some kind of erosion control put into place.
Where the sidewalk is gone?
I'm not sure. I just saw I saw a lot of exposed soil.
The sidewalk went in today as far as the rough grading, and the road base was brought up to grade. And they were working the entire length of the road to schedule a paving for Friday, so there has to be disturbed there.
All I can say is that the code enforcement officer had been out there last fall, and he felt that there were still areas that had not been seeded that should have been done last fall.
Just so I understand or refresh my mind exactly the purpose of the letter of approval. When we originally approved the subdivision, I guess my questions are directed toward our planner. We did approve the entire subdivision, but we didn't allow Mr. Kennedy to proceed with building different phases until appropriate letters of credit were posted for those phases. That's correct?
That's correct.
So what we're acting on right now is an amount of a letter of credit we have approved and originally requested by a certain date that has not been submitted.
Correct.
Then it seems to me whether we go to the June meeting or the July meeting, I would certainly favor perhaps making a final extension with receipt of evidence of compliance from DEP and perhaps Soil and Water Conservation or Soil Conservation Service. And if that deadline is not met, that this letter of credit approval just completely lapse, and that we start from square one and look at the amount again, because it doesn't make sense for me to continually approve a letter of credit and then the deadlines keep passing. I think that might put a little more pressure on the deadline being met.
Janet McKay?
I don't disagree with anything that Ms. Lardner has suggested. I guess my concern is if we've raised a question about the and requested the applicant to demonstrate compliance with the DEP erosion control approval, it seems to me that the only way you can demonstrate that is to get somebody from the DEP to tell us whether or not they're happy with it. We can't go out and say this is what they meant and this is agreeable. So I would be in favor of extending the letter of credit no more than 30 days and being quite direct in our requirements that we'd like for you to demonstrate compliance instead of just verbally assure us that you have complied.
By demonstration,
a
written statement from the Department of Environmental Protection, from David Ladd. If that's what you're seeking is the definition of demonstration in this matter,
I think
that's
at
clear.
This point, this is what we'd be looking at. Do I have any more comment from the board?
Madam Chair, I concur. The only thing I would change is not to limit it not more than 30 days, because I don't think our next meeting may be 31 days from now. The normal June meeting, the regular June meeting. Why be normal, right? With the same condition to demonstrate. I thought that's what we're going to see tonight or with mm-hmm. this packet. To demonstrate compliance means not simply come here and say that, well, it's okay. It's some written form from the DEP.
I agree, except I think that I agree with everything you said, except that I would go to the July meeting. Only because there's, I mean, we've got 3 weeks hanging in for some waste, I'm sorry, what was the name of that?
Level one hazardous waste audit.
Right, and I just want to have plenty of room on that before it comes back with it to, you know, oh, it's coming in today or it will be here tomorrow, and then we're back in the same thing.
The other issue that I might just advise the board on is that David Ladd is one of three or four enforcement officers at the Portland office, and it's very difficult to track his time. One of the reasons that we couldn't get a letter is because he is busy, and I think with a little bit of lead time, we can make sure that we would have the letter. Recognizing that your submission deadline precedes the actual meeting date, getting the letter from David and getting him out to the site, getting the letter then after that, and getting that into Maureen in time puts us under a bit of a time constraint. So July would be helpful in that regard.
Was the original soil and erosion control report reviewed by the Cumberland County Soil Service?
Yes, it
for
was.
DEP?
Yes, Ross Cutlitz did the original review, yes.
It would seem appropriate to me then that someone from that agency, if they're more available, would be an adequate substitute to confirm that the erosion control measures are up to design.
That would make it far easier on us rather than David if Ross Cutlitz's approval will substitute as a demonstration.
Do you have any comment from the board on that?
That would be acceptable to me.
I think that's acceptable all the way around.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you. So do we have a motion? We have all our comments. Do you want to talk some more?
Let's make a motion be it ordered that based on the request of the Greater Portland Development Group and the facts presented, the letter of credit submission deadline for Phase 1B and 2A of the Highlands, the 20-lot subdivision, be extended to the regular July meeting of the Planning Board, the applicant will demonstrate compliance with the subdivision erosion control plan.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any comment? Judy Wagner?
Would you like to include in that motion some reference to failure to meet this deadline shall result in withdrawal of approval of this letter of credit amount, something to that nature?
I don't mind doing that, but I don't know that it needs to be made a part of the motion. That would certainly be my intent, but okay. If you would rather. I guess by consensus, the board, if they want to add that as amendment.
Yeah, I don't see it as a point. No. I think we all pretty much on the same wavelength, how we feel about it. Any further discussion? All those in favor, indicate by raising your right hand. Opposed? Passes 4-1. Janet McKay opposing.
I have one other issue that I'd like to just raise with the board for consideration. In the event that the hazardous waste audit gets completed and the letter of credit comes forward in the amount that's specified quickly before the June meeting, and we are able to get the letter from Ross Cutlitz as well done quickly, would it be possible for us to submit the plats to you this evening to sign and have Maureen hold in the event that we can get the paperwork in place? Is that a possibility?
Maureen, do you want to?
I guess if you're talking about giving to us right now.
Yes.
Yeah, I usually like to go over those before I give them to the board. However, the board also has workshop meetings where I can gather their signatures. So if you get the plats to me and you're under some kind of time constraint, I can usually expedite those.
Good. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Okay. Thank you. The next order of business while the applicant is setting up his display is Rosewood Subdivision. Request by Joseph Frustacci for minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and a public access waiver for Rosewood, a five-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Woodland and Mitchell Roads, pursuant to section 16-2-3 sub 6, 19, I'm rattled, 19-3-9-3 sub A and 19-4-2 sub B of the subdivision ordinance. Looks like Courtney Jones is back. Would you introduce yourself again?
I'm Courtney Jones from Titcomb Associates. Just go over that. There's been a design change since the last time you saw this.
Madam Chair, I hate to interrupt. Okay. I just thought of it, and only because it was brought up by Mr. Emery this morning. Mr. Fustashi, I think, is the assistant coach, or maybe a coach on my daughter's little league team. I knew that the first time, and had not. I've been a little league coach for a long time, and I certainly never thought that it would bias my the toughness of my questions, or the easiness of my questions, or my deliberations. I'll leave it up for input to the board. If they wish that I sit or recuse myself from this, I will. I hadn't thought of it in that vein before.
I think you really ought to ask Mr. Emery what his real reason was for recusing himself the last time.
I think that's more to the point.
Do we have any other input from the board on this? I think that, I certainly think that you can rise above any little league or big league conflicts that might occur.
I think that's my feeling anyway. I think
and
it is appropriate to ask the other board members. I just want to let you know that.
Crucial. Well, I'm just doing a mental tally of who my kids are involved with, and I'm safe. Joe Hammond's not anywhere, is he? Okay. Go ahead, Courtney.
Okay. The biggest change is you changed the hammerhead turnaround on Edgewood Road. The original design was up here next to Seifert's lot, and then we had it incorporated into the driveway. Now we have it over here. With this is the actual gravel part, and then there's also going to be an easement around that, too. And Bob Malley has just called me today and said he has no problem with that. I don't know if you have any questions. That change, I don't think, is on the plans that you have. Okay. I'm just going to quickly go through Maureen's memo, explain that the changes that have been made since the last meeting. There's an easement for, there was a missing easement that's now included for the lot 5. The building envelopes have been changed. There's now a building envelope and a clearing envelope on each lot. Which restricts the buildings just to the building envelope and clearing just to the clearing envelopes, no clearing outside of those envelopes. There's also noted on the plan. And Joe did go out and do an additional site walk on the site to see where we would propose landscaping for certain lots at the board's request, and as shown in the plan, there's a total of 20 white pines proposed as buffers. I can just jump ahead to there was a letter from an abutter, Mrs. Earnhardt, who abuts this lot right here, who requested some buffering. And Joe's site walk, he noticed that the area that did need screening was down here, and this is where we're proposing the trees for that lot. We've added a note that the private road can be adjusted, field adjusted within the right-of-way to avoid cutting any trees. The fire department has requested a note to be added, which I have already added to my plans. It does not show on your plan that if the Rosewood Drive is ever extended, then the water line will be upgraded to 8 inches and a fire hydrant will be added. Okay, we've officially changed the name to Rosewood. That's on all plans. The pedestrian easement has been described in meets and bounds. Per the fire chief, a note has been added that the driveways should be a minimum of 10 feet wide with 12-foot clearance. We've renumbered the lots so that they consecutively go 1 through 5. Note's been added to the erosion control plan and report that areas, exposed areas, shall be seeded by September 15th. Let's skip over number 11. We're going to skip over number 12 for right now. We have had the pond tested, and I have the results with me for that. That will just be kept on record with the town, I believe, and the Conservation Commission. For the question about entrance landscaping, Joe has offered to place up to $2,500 in escrow account for landscaping subject to the approval of the town planner. We feel that we can't really design an entrance until after the road is built to see what exactly the ledge is going to look like and what the entrance will need. Okay, and because of number 15 about the turnaround, that is why we redesigned that hammerhead from this memo's question. Okay. I also wanted to add that we did have a wetland vegetation study done that showed that there was no more wetlands on the site than Alfred's report had shown, so that the snap as it stands is sufficient, apparently. Okay. And Maureen just handed us tonight a letter of review from the town attorney, who has a couple drafting issues, little questions on numbers that should be shown in the plans, which I can do. It's minor things. The one issue that we may want to talk about is that he brought up that the 10-foot wide, as the easement stands right now, provides that the 10-foot wide footpath easement can be relocated after advice and consultation with the Conservation Commission, and the lawyer is advising or suggesting that that might be changed to approval of the town council or the town, not just advice and consultation. I think right now Mr. Frustacci wants to just stay with advice and consultation and not upgrade that to approval. And regarding the drainage issue, as you remember, there was Dick Davis, the landowner across the street, had a problem with the flooding. And we've been working on this, and I'm going to let Joe tell you what's been happening so far.
My name is Joe Frustacci. We've had several conversations with three engineers, a planner, Bob Malley, and a number of other people regarding this drainage problem or situation. The water seems to be pooling up as a result of an overflow from the pond and then coming down approximately 45 feet to a culvert, which has been described as undersized. There's several reasons why it's undersized. I think that's all they could put in the road at the time that they were installing culverts there. There's all ledge, and possibly there wasn't an awful lot of water going across the road. But now it seems to be a problem on several rainstorms. We've had a lot of rain in the last few years, and in great amounts, and it is causing a problem by pooling up for a period of time during a one-day, 24-hour stretch. The amount of water going across the street is restricted by the 10-inch culvert. There's been some suggestions as to how to mitigate this problem, not alleviate the problem, but mitigate it, and that's by increasing the size of the culvert to an 18-inch culvert, and also providing a ditch system, a along the Woodland Road. Now, for several months, we've been talking about the subdivision, and I've heard from most of the people, in fact, from all the people, save the trees, limit cutting trees, limit ditching and causing problems with the roots of trees. But the three engineers that we've talked with didn't hear that and aren't sensitive to that. They have a situation that they're trying to remedy, and their solution is to put approximately a 480-foot ditch from the high point of the road all the way down through.
Right.
And that is up here somewhere. And a ditch system, as described by the engineers, is approximately 8 feet wide. And by cutting 8 feet wide from the Woodland Road into Rosewood, you're going to be exposing ledge that we talked about at the last meeting. You're going to be cutting down a lot of trees that the residents across the street in the apartments do not want cut down, that the Conservation Commission does not want cut down. I certainly do not want cut down and in effect, exposing ledge and wiping out what we're trying to save. We've talked at some length, and I don't think we're going to come up with an easy answer. We were asked to come up with a compromise or work on a compromise last meeting. We've talked probably every day since our last meeting, and there's real no easy way to resolve the problem. My proposal, and I think you have a memo from T.Y. Lynn Associates, was to put the ditch system from the overflow of the pond and increase the culvert size from a 10-inch culvert to an 18-inch culvert. We're not suggesting that that's going to alleviate the problem, but certainly it will reduce it considerably. There's blasting involved to go from a 10-inch culvert that's right on the surface to down 18 inches. It is not an easy problem, and this is why it has not been addressed by the town. We're willing to participate. We're willing to help out. But we also don't want to leave a devastated area in our path. It's something that's worth considering long and hard. One of the suggestions on the memo was to have a site walk. It's difficult to remember well on that one site walk that we had, and I've been over there several times, and I'm still seeing new things. And I was there this evening at 4 o'clock. And to provide a ditch system, as an engineer would describe, is not really, I think, feasible for this. But to provide a smaller ditch system without disturbing a lot of the vegetation is a possibility. We would be willing to do that and try to save as many trees as we possibly can. We're talking some beautiful maple trees and some beautiful oak trees there. Also, the buffered zone between woodland and the 20-foot buffer, 30-foot buffer that we put in this area would be preserved. It's not an easy issue. It's not an easy issue. It's expensive. It's involving a lot of site work. And we need additional input from what we have. We're coming to you with no definite proposal this evening. We're coming with a suggestion, and we're looking for some input from you, the board, as to how you want to address this. Again, we want to resolve the problem as best we can.
Thank you. Before we go any further, I just want to, and I don't want it to diffuse your very good presentation on this this issue, but I have been advised by the planner, and I think this will all tie in together, that there were apparently some abutters who were not noticed of the public hearing the last time through. And it I feel strongly that it's a project. There are a lot of people involved in it who care a lot. They apparently have also contacted the town with regard to why they weren't and how come they've missed out on it. I'd like the board's input on their feeling about having another public hearing at the next meeting. Relative to that, I think that my own personal feeling is that I would really like to see another sidewalk looking at this ditching issue before the next meeting and go on from there to discuss it. Do I have any question or comment from the board?
I'd like to find out if there's anybody here tonight who came thinking that they might speak to this issue, or Maureen, have you had particular conversations with people?
There are some people here tonight who would like to speak, but they knew that there wasn't a public hearing scheduled for this evening, so they're here out of interest, but they would very much like to have another public hearing scheduled so that they can have an opportunity to express their concerns.
I don't mean to pry, but I guess I am curious. We followed our procedures the last time, but we just didn't do as good a job as we normally do, or what?
I believe that under the ordinance requirements, we met the letter of the ordinance requirements. However, it's always been my policy and that every abutter should get a notice, and not every abutter received a notice. We missed most of the people on Angel Terrace. So it was partially staff error and partially I feel of omission in our ordinance standards.
I guess I'd be very interested in having a public hearing. I don't know, I mean, a continuation of the public hearing. I don't know whether Mr. Frustaci has a comment on it or not.
Why don't we continue to poll the board? Mr. Etzel?
I would, number one, any future meeting, and correct me if I'm wrong, has to have the mutual agreement of the applicant in the minor subdivision. Because of the time constraint. So I think we do have to ask the applicant. My own opinion, I don't want to drag this out for any more months than it has to be. And I certainly realize that we're under obligation to publicize a public hearing. The inclusion of a public hearing, and I direct this through the planner, does that automatically extend one more meeting? In other words, can a vote be taken at the time, at the, I guess I can almost answer myself, I don't know why we can't take a vote at the same meeting as a public hearing.
This is correct.
Okay. I certainly would be in favor, and I know that there are people who are interested in speaking. I'd certainly be in favor of having another public hearing.
Do we have any other comment from the board with respect to this one issue right now? Mr. Emery?
I would be in favor of another public hearing. I would just like to reiterate what Steve said. I keep looking at this as a four-unit project, and I don't know what the applicant's schedule is, but there are some other concerns here regarding drainage, but those concerns exist today. Regardless of whether houses are put on there, and I don't know there's any significant impact from this development to that situation. And it indeed seems like a town and developer public-private sort of thing that has to be resolved. In this time of sort of slow economic situation, anything that we can do as a board to help move the process along effectively and efficiently, I would like to go along with. I would, except for the legal, if it were in fact a strict legal issue that the public has to, the people who weren't notified have to have an opportunity to speak a public hearing, if that's in fact a legal requirement and that can't be notified until the next meeting, then I appreciate that and I agree with that that process. If on the other hand there are only several people involved and they're ready to speak tonight and it's not something that would legally hold up the project, then I would be in favor of hearing those opinions tonight, as long as everyone who's voiced a concern or who needs to be notified is present tonight. Do we have any indication of that?
There's no guarantee that people who didn't receive a notice before would have found out about it and come tonight.
Okay.
Well, the long and short of it is I believe every member of the public who has a right to speak should have that opportunity. And I also would like to see this move along as quickly as possible.
I agree with you. Well, why don't we let Mr. Fisacci throw in his additional few cents here?
Obviously, I'd like to move this along, too.
No.
We're into the building season, and it's my intention to do as much building this year as possible. With continued delays, we're into next year, which is not something that I would be comfortable with. There are also several issues that I think are major issues, the drainage problem, that we cannot resolve this evening. I encourage the site walk. I would encourage resolving the issues, discussing as much as we can tonight, so we can prepare ourselves for responding to the concerns prior to a final approval. I would like to have the approvals. I mean, we're shooting toward the approvals next month. Not conditional, but complete.
Mm-hmm.
I know there are several issues that the town planner has discussed with us that we couldn't get resolved tonight. So, you know, provided we can hopefully resolve things in 30 days with the public hearing and there's no new concerns, I'm not opposed. I'm not opposed.
Well, I see a scenario looking something like this. This is what I would envision. I do want to get the project moving. You are heading into, the whole building season, and you've even got your sign up, I think, out there.
Someone has placed a sign.
Someone's placed a sign.
Some hungry real estate broker. Yes.
No one on our board, no doubt. No. I see tonight we will schedule a public hearing for the next meeting. We'll have a site walk between now and then. With respect to the ditching and that, I would hope that we could have enough input among you and the engineers and the town, Bob Malley, I can't remember what this is, Public Works Director, the town planner, even if we're out there, so that this can all be resolved pretty nearly, if not completely, by the time we get to the next meeting, so it's not another burning issue that we have to rehash all over again. I appreciate what you're trying to do, working with the town to resolve the water issue and the draining. I would also like tonight to get through all the other stuff so that when we come into our meeting next month, we've got our public hearing, we've got all, we listened, but we have all the little things that I want to mention as well as, so we can move along and proceed without anything more dragging along. Does that sound agreeable?
It sounds good.
It sounds good? Shall we try for it? Well, why don't we get down, you do have things, I'm sorry, Mr. Eichenberg.
Is there any reason why we can't hear from people that are here today that would like to speak today, notwithstanding the fact that they could also speak next month? That might help take care of any of the problems that they may have. Give us a month to resolve some of those problems rather than hearing them for the first time next month.
If the applicant has no problem with it and the board has no problem?
It would be beneficial for us to hear the comments now so if there are some severe or major concerns, we can address them between now. For example, we received a letter over the, since the last meeting, concerning ledge blasting and trees. And we've addressed it on the plan. We put some trees in where there should be some. And I'm prepared to answer the ledge issue, blasting issue tonight. So I'm not opposed to that.
Okay, well then in that note, we will open an informal public hearing if such a thing exists. And do we have anyone that would like to speak?
Why don't we say that we closed the public hearing last month, but we reopened it to take the particular estimate?
Well, that sounds... We will reopen the public hearing that was opened last month and will be reopened next month.
Mm.
Would you introduce yourself and tell us where you live, please?
Certainly. I'm Mike Siepert, and I'm a direct abutter to the Rosewood Project on Edgewood Road. My piece of property is on the Cape Elizabeth, you know.
Did the plan right?
Yeah.
You're in the white block.
In the black white spot here. Okay. I'm not prepared this evening to talk or to comment. I'd much prefer a public hearing next month to give myself a chance to prepare for it, because I'm an emergency marine. I just recently got home last Friday, so I'm still trying to catch up on all the issues here. So as far as speaking on it tonight, I'm really not prepared.
I understand that.
Okay?
Right.
Thank you.
Excuse me, I have one question. You will be here next month?
I will be here next month,
yeah. Thank you.
Do we have anyone else that would like to come up and speak? Would you please?
Hi, my name's Allison Earnhardt, and I'm the person that wrote the letter. And I came tonight to see what the response might be to that, and I appreciate the intent on adding more trees. But there are already plenty of trees there. I'm not looking for more trees. My concern is the closeness of where the new house will be on that lot. With so many acres of trees, I'm hoping that maybe we could move that house a little bit further away from where we are. Because, like you mentioned, on the blasting, I'm very concerned about that. And also, that house is like right on top of ours. So,
Ms. Earnhardt, could you tell us where you live based on the map there?
So here's Lot number 3, and I'm right directly behind. The issue is not more trees to solve the, that's not going to solve my problem. My problem is blasting and a house being too close. And although I appreciate the intent, there's already lots of trees back there that we're going to lose quite a bit of. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone else? Please come.
Marcus, my name is Martin Pfizer, and I live at 29 Angel Terrace. The house is owned legally by my wife, Susan Donovan. And we also had not been given any notice at all of the last meeting. It was a public hearing. And I learned about the whole project, really, only about 6-7 days ago. So I would appreciate, and my wife too, if the meeting, the public hearing would be next month, so we could prepare ourselves.
Okay.
Because one of the houses, I believe it's lot number 5, would be directly next to our house. This will be right here. This house here, and we live over here. So the house will be 20 feet away from our line, mm-hmm.
property
line.
What is your wife's name?
No, it's Susan Donovan. I guess it's Caroline
Donovan. Oh, I see that. Okay.
That's her legal first name. And so really, we would like to prepare ourselves. Which is having any notice of time, so.
Okay, I can understand that. Thank you. Be here next month.
Okay.
Do we have anyone else that would like to speak? One more?
Thank you. Excuse me, my name is Edward Kane. I live on Edgewood Road. And I'd like to, the one thing that I would ask, Mr. Frasascia of the board to encourage Mr. Frasascia to do, whether or not the ordinance requires it, something was suggested by Mr. Emery last time, was a build-out plan for the project. I think Mr. Emery said that he'd done a lot of work in South Portland, were this in South Portland, that there would be a build-out plan, and I think It almost defies common sense to suggest that one of the houses with 16 acres that runs from Mitchell Road to Edgewood Road is going to be retained for any significant amount of time in anything resembling that sort of configuration. And as I said, I think the people in my neighborhood, and I, speaking for myself at least, we really don't care about that house being there. I mean, I think it would be a nice house stuck at the end of the street. But if there is going to be an attempt to put a little better than two houses per acre in the remaining 12, 14, 13 acres, whatever it is, that's a matter of concern. We think we have the right to ask the question now, is that the plan? And if that's not the plan, then we think that the plan as approved eventually by this board should reflect that fact in a legally significant way. And I'd mention one final point. The Courtney said that this was, that the wetlands plan didn't show any difference from what Mr. Frick's soils map had showed. It did show a difference from the little colloquy last time that we were here on the subject, where I had said I was pretty sure by anybody's definitions these were wetlands, and I was corrected by Courtney on that, and it turns out that it's described, I think, by the Woodlot Alternatives as a, I think they were, as a protected wetland zone. So it's just, I think it was wise to do that. I think you got the result that some of us anticipated. But I do think it's fair for people in South Portland who may, in fact, bear the brunt of the, quote, impact of development, close quote, to be able to ask the question, what is the real plan here? That's all I have to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? Does the applicant wish to speak again? Given it, yes, you.
My turn?
Your turn again.
No,
I will after you speak. Is that the rule?
If you want to address any question, any of the questions.
It's informal anyway.
This is Courtney Jones again. I'd just like to address a couple of the issues that were brought up. Concerning Mr. Kane's mention of the soil here, this was identified as hydric soil by Mr. Frick and corroborated by Woodlot Alternatives. We are identifying it on the plans as that. It's been shown all along. My mistake for not calling it wetlands. I try not to say wetlands. And for Mrs. Earnhardt, and I can appreciate anybody who has a development looming in their backyard, but I just want to mention that there's only a 20-foot setback required in this zone, and we're providing 50 feet for lot two. And we're also providing a fairly restrictive building envelope, which is much more restrictive than the regular zoning here, which we would necessarily have to adhere to. So that we are increasing the buffer required by at least 30 feet, and that the location of the house is somewhat restricted to the location of the septic and the layout of the ground. And there's not really much room where we could push that house any further. I feel that the envelope that we are providing is sufficient in that area. Mr. Frustaccio?
Yes. It's finally nice to meet Mr. Siepert after all these months. Or see him anyway. and we will probably have an educational meeting to discuss what we're doing and the fact that when you bought that piece of property, you didn't get all that you were supposed to get, and that was legal access to your house, which we are working on to give to you. Secondly, Mrs. Earnhardt, I read your letter, and I think I received it last week, the middle or towards the end of last week. And I did go out to the job site. I thought your house was was located, the second one in from Woodland Road. I did not see that it was the white cape up on the hill. And you're right, there are a lot of trees between your house and Lot 2 that's described here. In fact, when I walked the site, I immediately told Courtney to mark out additional pine trees here, which will act as a buffer, because most of those trees on the lower area are in the, I'm not going to use the word wetlands, but in the lower land where no trees have had a chance to really develop and grow. So we're going to try to put some pine trees, which might kind of shield this particular house and Lot 2. This is a building envelope. Right, and the house will be adjusted within that building envelope. On the plan that we show here, it does look a little closer to the back of the property than it really and truly will be. Again, in my site walk this afternoon, I took your concerns to heart, and I think you'll see where the septic system is located. And the house will be closer to the front of the front of the lot than towards the back of it. Also, there's some pretty good soils there, and we do not anticipate blasting on that particular lot, which will not or should not interfere with your house or your foundation. But typically, when we do blasting, it's not going in and putting a lot of dynamite in one particular area and blowing it up. It's kind of restricted. Anybody in the blasting business has insurance, and I think it's $1 million. I'm not sure if the planner can help me out, but I think that it's required as $1 million policy. And again, typically, there's a seismologist that does a survey of any foundations, video cameras, and it's registered, the amount of blasting or the charge and any type of vibration. And we have blasted in the past year on a lot tighter lots than what we have out here with absolutely no problems. I'm using the same blasters. We're talking houses that were probably 40 feet apart, 50 feet apart, and there have been no problems. Your letter addresses concerns if there is damage, if there is a problem, what is your recourse? They're insured, I'm insured. Your recourse is, you know, against us. It's not a lengthy process. You don't have to get an attorney as you showed concerns in your letter. We can't function without proper insurance, and they can't function if they do not respond to the claims. So I don't think that you'll have any problems. I hope I've addressed. I hope I've addressed most of the concerns in your letter. Oh, yeah, you made a reference, and if I may, mm-hmm. You made a reference about photographers or something going out to your property. We've had surveyors out there, but there's been no photographers, so I don't know what your neighbor, you know, was seeing, but there were surveyors out there, and generally they're identified with their bigger equipment as opposed to smaller cameras. Okay. And there's been another issue raised by Mr. Kane about what we're planning to do on the remaining acreage. I have no plan at this time. It is something that we're not working to, you know, put more houses in there. It's right now the plan that's before the planning board is what we have in mind, and we're not entertaining coming in here, you know, next year or the year after with another plan. It's not my intention to do so. However, zoning restricts the number of houses per acre. There's a number of other things that restrict what can be done down there, and I am not going to fight what can or what cannot be done. It's not my intention. That is, I am not planning an additional subdivision in the near future. We have indicated, I think, on the in the easement or the language, the legal documents, that the road will not go through to Edgewood Road, that it will never go through. I think we've added this, and that was a result of your concerns last meeting. So.
Mr. Eckenberg.
Yes, Madam Chairman, I think it would be helpful for the people in the audience if Mr. Pistacchi could indicate on the map where the other there are two critical wetland areas on your property, I believe. One is the pond, which is indicated on this map. In critical wetland zones, you cannot build in them or within buffer zones of 100 to 250 feet, depending on the site. And that is a real development constriction in this particular case. There's also another critical wetland area on the northern part of the property that perhaps Mr. Pistacchi could indicate to you, and that is another development restriction which would inhibit the ability to develop further that property. So that may alleviate some of your concerns in terms of what future development plans are possible on that parcel.
The definition of critical wetland is has to be an acre or more, and that's why the pond is a critical wetland. The other area I don't believe is a critical wetland. It's a wetland protection zone. Is everything that is cross-hatched is wetland protection zone. And I understood that the only one that was critical wetland was the pond, which was over an acre in size.
The report you submitted indicated there were two critical wetland areas in the other property.
Ms. O'Meara?
I believe that the Woodlot Alternatives report talked about two critical wetland areas, but they're contiguous. It's the pond and an area just west of the pond, and the report dealt with them as two critical wetlands because I guess the ecology was different, but under our ordinance, they're treated as one total area. The area on the northern part of the site is classified as a wetland protection zone.
Yeah. They were just talking about these as two different pieces of the same, and we're calling it one. The status of this is the same as everything else that's cross-hatched on here, which is definitely a development issue, but not in the critical wetland sense.
Thank you.
Do we have any other comments from the board while we're here right now?
I have a question. In Lot 5, the turnaround is referred to as a temporary turnaround easement. What does that refer to? The fact that it's there for snow plowing, or why would that not be? Isn't that the only method for anyone who comes down this dead-end street to turn around?
That is, yes. That street is approximately, I think, 140 feet long. And most people that go down there, they'll either go, stop, park in the middle of the road and walk into the property, go to the pond, or they would be visiting people. And the turnaround would be for emergency vehicles, snow plowing vehicles, people that just happen to get lost.
Mr. Emily, is your question, why is it temporary instead of
yes.
permanent?
Mm-hmm.
Why would it be temporary instead of permanent?
Well, this was discussed with Bob Malley, and I guess it's the way it's constructed as opposed to blacktop and paving. And we moved it, no? Okay, well, we originally had it on the other side of the road when we had the sidewalk. That's when it was planned to be over in this side of the road here. But because of the terrain and the woods and the ledge and all, it was converted to the other side, and
Maureen, do you want
to? I do know that the town engineer has also questioned why it would be indicated to be temporary. And I think the town, in the whole set of of comments on the different deed languages that we would like to see that turnaround easement be described as permanent.
Okay, we had it as part of the driveway, and that was a permanent.
Right.
And then between
I think they're two separate issues, though. There's an issue of where it ought to be located, and there's an issue of whether it should be permanent or temporary. And, yeah.
I was just using the detail that was sent to me, and I remember the survey and I were talking about if we should write temporary or not, and I didn't know, and I just wrote temporary. But if you want that erased, that's no problem.
I think so. I think of temporary as being like a temporary construction easement, which at the end of however long it takes you to do whatever it is you're doing, it becomes non-existent. And
Madam Chair,
anyway.
I was hoping that our attorney would address that. I didn't fully read their letter, but I don't think that they addressed that, the temporary. But if the applicant's willing to take that off from the plan, I'd rather see it taken off.
I would, too. Any other comment? Pretty much. Another thing is getting the attorney's things at the night of the meeting. It's hard. One of the other things I wanted to speak to Mr. Kane about is that this plan, as approved, as it is now, anything else that's ever done with that existing remaining part of Lot 4 will have to come back to the board for a whole new set of planning board approval. I do think that with the densities, and it's naive to consider that there's nothing ever contemplated or that may never be built there. But at least we do have the safety of, as it's presented now, it will be approved. Any change to it would also have to come before planning board approval, or any subdivision that would be taken as part of it would have to be. All right.
Is the interpretation of the town's attorney that under the subdivision law, even after 5 years, this would be considered an amendment to the subdivision?
Yes. Yes, because it's approved as a lot right now. It's Lot 5.
Pardon?
It's just one great big Lot 5. Lot 4.
I just wondered whether or not among the land attorneys there was a group disagreement on whether or not after 5 years,
I'm going to defer to him.
I did discuss that with the town attorney, and he was going to look into it further. What he recommended is that in addition to relying on our ordinance, which clearly states that any change to a previously approved plan must come back to the planning board, he also recommended that a note be added to the subdivision plat itself that says that any change would have to come back to the planning board. So even if there was a disagreement among land use attorneys, once the note is added to the plat, it takes effect for this particular subdivision.
So we'll see that note, right?
I have no problem in adding that note. Let me also point out that it's also been suggested that if ever another lot is put in this area, an 8-inch water line has to be installed, plus a fire hydrant. Secondly, if we come in from this side and do any improvement, then Mr. O'Malley will have something to say as far as doing more to the road, which will involve bonding and major road improvements and all that. So we have pretty much been dictated by the ordinances and everything else as to what we're going to do. So please rest assured that we will be in compliance, and there's going to be a lot of people addressing or at least reviewing what we're doing. So that is not a problem, adding that language.
I can understand having to change the water lines and put in sewers. Yep. I mean, that's
but I want to reiterate that there's going to be a lot of scrutiny on this down the road if there are changes. I mean, And we've heard that concern at two meetings now, and I'm sure we're going to have it again next month. But there are constraints on what we're going to do.
Ms. McKay?
Mr. Versace, I'd like to respond to the, or perhaps a partial response to your request to get a little more information about the ditching versus culverting. Have you met with Dick Davis about this, he being the person who raised the issue in such graphic detail last time? And if so, does he have a particular position on the suggested remedies?
I talked to the engineer that he hired to review this at some length, and I asked him if he would design a solution, and he called Mr. Davis to see if he would pay for the design of the solution, at which point he said, no, we can't, or we won't, I won't do that. And that is the extent of the conversation I had with that side of the road, actually. Mr. DeLuca has been very helpful in his suggestions and his comments, and doing it without pay. But I think that he should be involved in it, in the discussions, and certainly should basically review what we're doing so that he understands completely where we're going and coming from.
I'd like to just say that I appreciate your willingness to try to reach a approach that would be amenable to all sides. I don't want us to lose sight of the fact that this is only a five-house subdivision and that you're not responsible for totally remedying a situation that looks like it was certainly pre-existing in a serious matter. But that's all I have to say for now.
The risk of being facetious, we could always put a note on the plan that any more lots they have to regrade and rebuild Woodland Road. Now, I want to keep this moving along. I was being facetious. But I would like to go through and give you my input on all the little jibs and jabs of things that I would like addressed or I'd like you to think about before we come back next month, as well as the input from the rest of the board. Do you want me to go ahead, or does someone else want to start with this? Go ahead. I'm comparing my memorandum from last month and this month. One of the things I picked up was on the landscaping buffering, a total of 20 white pines were proposed. And I had noted on my last month's that they were going to be 6 to 8 feet. You have not stated any size. I was just wondering what kind of an idea you had on that.
I think the plan shows that they're 5 feet. 5 feet tall.
Mm-hmm. Not this plan.
Not this plan. Ah. That's been revised since the Maureen pointed that out, and I've added this.
The pedestrian easement. This was something that you brought up when you first spoke tonight with respect to the difference between whether or not it would be approved by the, or done with the mutual consent of the town. Do I have any board input on this particular issue?
Sorry, what issue? I was trying to find something in my ordinance.
Ah, indeed.
What was
it? I'm sure. It was the issue of the pedestrian easement being relocated. There was an issue of whether or not it was going to be relocated with the approval, the town council approval or the planning board approval, or with just simply the mutual agreement of the conservation committee, planning board, and the applicant, or something like that. Maureen, maybe you can direct me on that.
the current language requires that the town advise on the relocation, whereas the Conservation Commission is strongly recommended that they be allowed to be, that the easement be relocated to a mutually agreeable location. Currently, the language does not allow the Conservation Commission to disagree with the location of the easement. They are merely allowed to make their comments.
Judy Lardner?
I would certainly favor adding some languages recommended by the town attorney, but perhaps further qualifying it that the town's approval shall not be unreasonably withheld in the instance that Mr. Frustaci would like to change that easement. And I think it'd be most likely if there were future development plans and that easement needed to be adjusted to allow for lots. In some ways, it doesn't make sense to me to grant someone an easement, but depending on placement, the easement could almost be taken away if the placement were not very sensitive. So I think the town, if it is going to receive the easement, should have some sort of say in where it's located or relocated.
Okay. Are we in agreement with that? That's a good... Janet McKay?
I'd like to hear from Mr. Frustaci about what his sentiments are, and you do apparently feel strongly about maintaining control of the placement of the easement even after granting it, and I'd like to understand more from your side.
This was incorporated on advice from council with the idea that if there were any future development, that the footpath would not interfere with a person's lot, privacy, private enjoyment. And that's why it was that we put that there. My sentiments are that I don't want it to interfere with anything down the road, but I am not adverse to allow an input in some fashion, provided it does not restrict us in anything that might happen down the road. Although it looks like it's in the middle of a future road, it's not. That's my sentiments, that I don't want to be restrained because of the language that we're agreeing upon tonight on something that, you know, might never happen or that we don't know what will happen down the road. So I just don't want to tie myself down tonight, but I'm sure that we could work something out that's agreeable.
Madam Chair?
Yes?
I'd like to further comment on that. Mr. Frustaci, I don't doubt your sincerity in the least, and I don't know how your future plans for development, if they'd occur. It seems to me that land will be prime, and whether you develop it or perhaps a future owner, I think it's likely, and I can see the need for perhaps relocating that. I think my concern is if the town doesn't have some sort of legal right, especially if we have a subsequent owner who would subsequently also own this easement, we don't have much protection. And if either your attorney or perhaps our attorney could come up with some language that would be mutually beneficial, which would allow us some legal say while preserving, definitely giving you the right to relocate and accommodate future plans.
It sounds good coming from you this evening, and I hope the same, you know, down the road, if someone comes in to develop it, that they have someone as sensitive as you on the board. Then 5 years, 10 years, or whatever, and I agree with you. I hope that our attorneys can work something out. I agree that we can reach some type of a compromise.
I would like to suggest that I thought Ms. Lardner's language was quite good about the consent not being unreasonably withheld or denied. So that might be a good place to start. Anyway,
I agree.
Okay, the next item is a performance guarantee. Does that need to be here just yet, or? we just answer that, Maureen?
Under the, I guess it's the last requirement, under preliminary subdivision approval, under minor subdivision approval, under the major subdivision approval, you don't have to deal with the performance guarantee issues until they come in for final subdivision approval. But this is a minor subdivision, so it's a one-stop approval process. Everything has to be done at this time. It does state here that if the board determines that security for performance is required for the completion of any proposed site improvements, then the procedures and standards of Section 16.2.4, which is basically the major subdivision letter of credit standards, shall apply. Unless the board feels that there is no requirement for a performance guarantee, then that still needs to be put together.
Do I have some input from the board on this one? I know what I'm thinking, but...
May I make a comment on
that? Yes.
Town planners provided me with a tentative escrow agreement that I believe the town attorney has not reviewed, nor has mine. I'd be more than glad to work on this between now and the next meeting. And basically, we've been in agreement that I am going to put money in escrow for this project in the amount that the town engineer has established is a reasonable amount.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we can avoid discussion today, but if that's agreeable.
That's fine. That's I think that solves it if we get those things ironed out before the next meeting in a way that's acceptable without having to hash it over again. Stormwater. We've talked about that. We're going to address it with the site walk and go from there. I have no problem with your escrowing the $2,500 for the landscaping, subject to our town planner's excruciatingly discriminating taste. I think she can be tough. She's better than I am. I'll leave it in her capable hands, if everyone else agrees. I guess those are my comments for right now. Do you have some others from the board?
Madam Chair.
Ms. Lardner.
I'll add some comments that perhaps we can address between now and the next meeting or on a site walk. First one is, I'm still concerned about what trees might be saved in the right-of-way where the private drive is going in, and since it sounds like we will be out at the site to examine the drainage, perhaps you could flag the trees that you think you might be able to get around just to get a sense, or if the town planner might be able to identify any more specific language that we could add on the plat or some sort of enforcement mechanism that trees will be saved. To me, the language is very loose right now, and I'm not convinced any trees will be saved. It seems you can have an argument, but at least give us a sense which ones you think you can move around.
Well, we have the building envelope.
Oh, excuse me, just
okay.
In the
building envelope.
No, excuse me, in the private drive right of way. Yep,
we've marked the center line on that, and most what I can mark is what's coming out.
Okay,
and then the other trees will basically...
I believe there's a note on there saying you will try to field adjust and save trees. If you have a sense what trees might be saved so we know that probably any others will be taken down, just to see if that means anything, actually, that any trees will be saved. There was also a comment in your consultant's letter from Woodlot Alternatives about a black gum tree or trees, and I would like to see that tree saved if it's as rare as he indicates, and perhaps some sort of note on the plat would achieve that end. I understand Mrs. Earnhardt's comments on the house placement on lot 2, and if you honestly feel that the placement of the house, as you have shown, is not where it needs to be, and I could see certainly it can come forward because there are no ledge outcrops marked on your plan. It can move toward the road and toward the septic system. I personally would like to see that building envelope tightened toward the back. Certainly, there's no requirement in the ordinance that you have to do it, but it would be nice if you could do that as a gesture of goodwill and good neighborliness. Yes, I can't even say that word, excuse me. Let's see. With respect to the blasting concerns, if there's not something specific in an ordinance with respect to videotaping any blasting activity, that might be an appropriate condition of approval to help those neighbors come to terms with that.
Perhaps Mr. Frustash would be willing to just add that as a note on the plan.
I can do that, but this is also a requirement of the insurance company of the blasters, and we will make sure that we have the insurance.
Okay, if it's a requirement, would you mind putting it on the plan, just that neighbors feel comfortable about that? Let's see if I've skipped anything. I guess I'm certainly interested a little more in investigating that turnaround location, since the board did have problems with your original location on Edgewood Road. I personally would like to see it, but I suppose I could do that on my own. And I guess I would like to add for the public, in South Portland, when we had a subdivision such as this in a large area that is left undeveloped, often the subdivider would put on the plans this area reserved for future development. I certainly would not want to force you to do that if that's not your intention, but it seems to me that neighbors have to assume that Mr. Frustashi can or any subsequent owners could develop that. Some soils are pointed out right now as falling under CAPE's wetland ordinance from some of the letters that we've received and some of the discussions we've had. I think it's very likely that those areas of Naskeag soil will cease to be known as wetlands in this town. I think there's a very strong argument for that to be the case, which would make that land even more attractive for development. So I guess I'd just like it stated that there is no guarantee on Mr. Frustashi's part that that land will remain undeveloped, and all neighbors, I think, would have to assume that. I think that's all I have to say now. Thank you.
Madam Chair, may I respond to
yes.
a comment that was made? You're asking to tighten up the building envelope on this lot. When you tighten up the building envelope, according to the language that we've provided, we're going to be tightening up the no-cut area. So I would not like to do that for the express reason that we're going to be shortening up what a person can develop for his own private enjoyment, i.e. a swimming pool, a lawn, a garden, or whatever. So that is a concern that I would have. We will look at Lot 2 and how we can move the house around. I walked it again this afternoon, and I looked at the placement of the house. It appears as though the septic system or some soils that we excavated are in the back portion of this. And I'm looking at this now, and I see the septic is down here. I'm wondering, and I'm going to look at this again, if the septic system is up here in this portion, then that would definitely limit where we place the house. We'd definitely bring it up here. But we will be looking at this between now and the next meeting. But I would have a concern about shrinking the building envelope just because of the cut language that we have in the areas outside the building envelope.
Mr. Emery.
Excuse me, just a couple of brief comments. Joe, it seems to me the further the houses are pushed into any of these lots, the more privacy is lost between both the existing neighbors and the new property owner. And the new property owners would have the benefit, if the houses were moved toward the road, of also enjoying the views across the road, which, if I remember correctly, are quite spectacular. And the floor plans that you're indicating here, I don't know what your plans are for design or construction of houses, but they look very similar to many houses, that there's a garage, there's a breezeway, there may be a family room, a kitchen, and then there's probably a front entrance and a front-to-back living room or something like that. But the issue of getting them to, even though you're well within the ordinance setback requirements, but thinking about what happens on the north side of those houses in terms of usable land. I mean, I don't build houses for a living, but if I were buying a house, I can think of a few ways I'd spin these around to take advantage of solar orientation and to create as much privacy on my lot and still allowing in sunshine. So I think that's really the only thing we're saying there. The issue of the road alignment, I think, is a real conundrum in that we've put a restriction within the existing right-of-way, and that right-of-way is only 30 feet wide and the road is 20 feet wide for most of its distance. I don't think that gives you much flexibility in getting around trees. If the board were willing to allow some flexibility in the easterly or right-hand right-of-way line in order to preserve trees, or if there's, we see that need during the site walk, that's something I would certainly be willing to discuss. I've just spent last weekend up in northern Maine where I saw a subdivision that did exactly that. It was built by the bulldozer, not by predetermined site distances and all of that, and it meandered very successfully around trees, and keeping in mind that you have to swing quite widely for large trees. If the board has any other discussions on that, but that's certainly something that may be necessary if we're truly interested in saving some of the trees. The last thing is two comments. One on the pine trees. I don't recall how densely shaded these lots are, but I do remember a very high overstory and very little understory, and that would indicate that there's not much sunlight getting down underneath, and I don't think the pine trees are going to do very well unless there's a lot of sunlight opened up into the understory. So that I would certainly be happy if you would put in some hemlocks there of a shorter height, maybe 4 to 5 feet, substituting for a 6 to 8 foot pine tree. I think that's about the same cost consideration. And I think the hemlocks would be more successful as an understory plant. And for one last jab, I guess I really feel like we're beating a horse here, but I want to keep this moving along as quickly as possible. I still will keep the location of Lot 5 and that house as, you know what my opinion was in terms of locating it on the other side, on the uphill side. I still feel quite strongly about that. That's something that I just have a personal preference for. If there are any issues that come up during discussion, during the public hearing, I would be interested to hear those. But I just, for the life of me, can't understand. I mean, I know there's issues of ledge on the uphill side, but why someone would want to build a house tucked in behind an existing house in a low-lying portion of a much larger site. There may be cost situations there that make that house more affordable. I think that's what you discussed last time, but I feel very strongly that it should be someplace other than where it's located. That's it.
Should I respond to his comments at this time? Or?
Go right ahead.
Okay, thank you. Regarding the placement of the building, of the dwelling on this plan, my personal opinion is they should probably be removed completely and just show the building envelope. Mm-hmm. These are quite far back from the road, as you pointed out, and I agree, and they will be located closer to the road for a variety of reasons. But mainly, I think we put the building there, and I don't know why. Courtney can say why, but they will not be there. They will be closer to the road, and they will be probably directed in a different, subtly exposure or whatever. But they were just placed on there for purposes of showing where they might possibly go. Secondly, on the pine trees that we've located on the plan, this lower area doesn't seem to have a lot of tall trees on it. As I mentioned, they're probably a lot of scrub brush there, and that's why we placed the pine there, and also along here. But I agree with your comments on this upper portion of Lot 3. This seems to be greater trees, taller trees. And we'll make that comment.
Have any other comments? Janet McKay?
I actually have a motion.
Oh, I have one more comment.
Have a question. No, go ahead.
All right. I have two more things to say. Number one is, I was just looking through the T.Y. Lind May 12th letter, which you probably have. There are a few little items there that I think can easily be addressed by the next meeting. I'm not going to go into them all right now that were highlighted. The second one is just one that has just within the last 30 seconds occurred to me with your building footprints on your plan. I had the uncomfortable situation of reviewing a mortgage inspection plan about 2 months ago that was built, the house was built in a place different than the footprint on the plan, and it nearly held up the closing while we went back and forth with the town, so that this was just a sort of that's right where we put it, so you'd have an idea where the house was. It didn't mean that it, well, the attorney for the buyer had taken the position that that was the way the subdivision was approved, and that was where the building had to go. So can we put one more note on your plan? That these are for reference only, and then the buildings can be built in any location within. I just don't want you to have any more trouble with that.
Courtney's looking to see if it's already
on. Oh, it could
there.
Be.
Yeah.
You do, because it was a bizarre situation. And it was okay. Over in Scarborough, and it threw a monkey wrench for several days into what was supposed to be a very smooth closing. Mr. Edsel, do you have another comment to make?
Yeah, I was just looking quickly. I thought that was, maybe it was another plan. But no, it is another plan. Later this evening has that on there. I'll try to limit this to questions that I think will help next month's discussion. I assume that we're going to be meeting on this again next month. And my toughest question will be first, and I hope you understand I ask this because financial and technical capability is the purview of this board. In our correspondence, we received a dismissal of foreclosure notification. Were you aware of the complaint of foreclosure during the time of application?
I don't know the timing of it, but as soon as I received it, I resolved the problem.
Okay. That was my second question. Is the non-performing status a resolved issue with this lender?
Yes.
Okay. Next question or comment that I have is just as one board member, I would prefer, I notice you're looking for a waiver of the first 50 feet of the private drive. The requirement for asphalt to be waived, I would prefer that it not be. There are benefits back and forth each way, and I think when we get through all of this drainage discussion of that area, that the best plan will be to have an asphalt entryway. The first 25 feet or so are on town-owned land, and then the 25 feet of your own. The difference between sheeting of water coming down the road and the kick out and spin out of dirt into the road, I think for appearance reasons, I think as one board member, I'd rather see 50 feet of asphalt entry into the subdivision. The question that I have, or more of a comment, on the field adjusting of the road, I see a 30-foot wide path, 30-foot wide right-of-way, and a 20-foot wide road. Certainly doesn't give you much of a room to move that. I take that the field adjusting has to stay within the 30-foot right-of-way. Okay. Is the 20 feet the full width of the improved road, or is that just the surface, the travel area?
That would be the travel area. Then you have your shoulders,
yeah.
I think, of an additional 4 feet.
Pretty much taking up the...
I think that if you come back on a sidewalk and we look at the trees once more, you'll be surprised and pleased. The lack of the cutting that we'll be doing. We will not be doing an awful lot. There are some large ones that have been basically are dying now, so I think that you'll be pleased, and maybe that issue will take care of itself on the sidewalk.
Okay. I concur with Mr. Emery on the buffering issue. Those my notes that the white pines aren't going to do well in that canopy area. I don't think, I think it's a good issue for us to all take another look at that, the buffering to the Earnhardt residence. I know we talked about buffering the improvement area. of septic systems, but I think it was more my intention, if there is a high canopy at the lot two, to put the buffer of evergreens between the house and the closest house, which would be the Earnhardt residence, not necessarily the septic. That lot, the septic system's 200 feet away from the closest neighbor. The additional lots, I think, just from my own read of this, is that you as the developer of this site have to bring us to some level of confidence or ease along with the general public. It has been on your mind, evidently, in the last month you've changed number 9 of the covenants and restrictions. A month ago it read that the declarant had the right to create up to 4 additional lots and to create a continuation of the private drive. Now, you sort of compromised. You've taken away the number of lots, is my understanding. I think the most recent one doesn't limit over the next 20 years. And you state that the shall not extend or construct Rosewood Drive as a connecting road or any or way from Woodland Road to Edgewood Road without a approval of at least 75% of the owners of Rosewood. And B, the approval of town planning board provided, however, nothing in this sentence shall prohibit such construction or extension at the request of said town and solely for the purpose of emergency vehicle access such as fire and fighting utilities. So there's some plan there. I don't know, it's your own judgment, what brings it to a level of comfort for the general public and for this planning board, but I think you're in the right direction here.
I think there's some concern and some clarification needed to that statement that the attorney put in. And I think he was talking about, the extension of Rosewood Drive. And we removed that. Remove that language so there wouldn't be any confusion. That was the intent. Also, we wanted to put some language in to put people at ease that road would not go through. And that was the intent of that change.
Okay. One last thing, and that I appreciate Mr. Frick writing a letter specifically. I think he misspelled my name.
He did.
But, he didn't correct that next time. I fully understand the situation, so he didn't really need to write me the letter. But I am interested in what you plan to do. Do you see any problem with dual septic systems, dual septic tanks for the sites that you have here?
It's a lot easier to put in 2 septic systems during the construction process than to put 1 in and then have the first homeowner come in and put a garbage disposal in and follow up the system and call me back a year later or whatever. We do not anticipate a problem with two septic systems.
I think that the chamber system development in the last few years is very good, but one of the key problems has been that bacterial growth that just floats straight through one septic tank. They're trying to develop other, and they do have some baffle systems that work better, but they will clog the chambers up very quickly, and lot two will have a direct, if there's a complication there within 5 years, you'll have a major contamination problem in the wetlands. I don't have any more questions.
Ms. Lardner.
Just like to add 2 quick comments that I missed, perhaps. With respect to the stormwater situation, it's hard to balance whether one requires more of a small developer when they're not adding a lot of increased flow, but one also can balance if there's a bad stormwater situation right now that development should be limited if that can't be restricted. So I'd be very interested in hearing some alternatives when we're out there, for instance, ditches to the easterly side of your private access road as opposed from the highest point. So we don't just go out there and look at it without some guidance as to what are the possible solutions. It might be helpful if you have a simplified sketch plan that would show where the post-development runoff will go. It's kind of hard for me to look at the second page of your plan and decipher all the direction of flows, but that would assist me in seeing what the situation will be out there when we're on the sidewalk. And the other thing is I would like to see some sort of sketch plan at least for the entrance landscaping. I don't feel comfortable turning over landscaping decisions to the town planner. If the board would agree to that, it could be something that could be amended, perhaps, by the town planner, but I'd like to look at something.
We have an unknown situation at the entrance, as it was brought up at the last meeting, with regard to once we get through blasting, where are we going to be and how much ledge is there. So it's very difficult for us to anticipate what we have to work with or don't have to work with. This drainage problem will also add to the unknowns, because right at this point, there's a potential drainage problem. And I say that if we extend the ditch up to here, all right, there's going to be more blasting. Mm-hmm. So it's very difficult. And I think in the sidewalk, we probably, and I hope that we can get some issues resolved so we can come back with some more definite plans. But until then, it's very difficult for us to do a site sketch. And, you know, I would rather stay with an escrow agreement so that, you know, we can work. Maybe after we do the blasting, then we can come back in at that point with a site sketch for approval. But I would not like to be limited at this particular time and have that as a condition of approval, because we don't know what's going to happen until maybe 60 days or 30 days after the approvals come and what we do, you know, with the blasting and the road and the ditch arrangement.
One question then to our planner. What is the precedent for, in essence, if that kind of approval with nothing to look at? It seems to me the design could almost be turned over to the town because we have the money. Is that a typical thing to be done?
I'm concerned with the delegation of authority to a staff member, but it has been the history of this board to delegate design issues to staff in the past. So, for example, I can think of an approval where the board delegated redesign of a parking lot to the town engineer's review without bringing it back for review. If it's up to the town planner, we'll probably be spending most of that money, if that's your answer to your question.
Perhaps you could give some thought to an appropriate way to deal with this prior to final approval of this, and whether that be some sort of expedited amended subdivision plan.
I would think the board could just make it a condition that the plan would have to come back at some point for board approval, just a landscaping plan.
Okay.
Yes, not to take anything away from the discretion of the town planner, but that would be a medium substitute that perhaps would, a medium range substitute that would might make us all feel comfortable.
I agree. Do we have any more comments?
Yes, just a couple. There seems to be some discussion about the setback on lot 2 to the Earnhardts, and I'm just wondering, do you have any idea where on the Earnhardts lot their house is located, how far from your lot line?
About 20 feet.
Excuse me? 70 feet from the common lot line?
Pardon?
70 feet from the mm-hmm. common lot line?
I think 20 feet from the lot line.
I believe it's 70 feet from my back door to my property line.
Okay, so 70 feet from the back of your house to the property line, then it's another 50 feet at least to the back of the building envelope, then more probably to the actual house itself.
Is that what? Somehow I had construed that your house was closer to your property line, and that it was perhaps 70 feet from the building envelope of the new home.
No, I am very bad with distances. I don't really. I know.
We'll.
I would guess it's a minimum of 50 feet.
Okay, we'll look at it when we go out there.
I think that'd be good because now it's okay. Years. If it is at least 120 feet or so, that's fair distance. I think in a prior meeting I had suggested that I would like to waive the first
I'm comfortable that I can put together a better list this time. If the board determines that they're going to schedule another public hearing, all the abutters will be mailed in their own notice, plus an ad will be put in the paper, and typically some kind of article is also placed in the Cape Courier. So that was done the last time. The problem was that the mailed notice to individual abutters was not complete.
When we go on our site walk, I have this sort of bad feeling about Woodland Road being opened up any further. I don't want to see any more trees cut down. I don't want to see the roads made any wider. It seems to me if we can remedy that problem, that would sort of be my preference. And regards to the entrance, it seems to me it's going to be a very short street with a very limited amount of homes. I would assume that the entrance feature, if you will, would be kept very minimal, very simple, not to invite lots of inquisitive traffic. And I just sort of saw a rhetorical question, but I think even on the sidewalk, maybe we could discuss that.
I agree, and I addressed that issue last meeting, and I would rather have it as a, you know, look like a driveway than a, you know, a subdivision such as Stone Gate or some of these others that have these elaborate entrance. They look beautiful, but it would probably encourage people to drive down through on a sightseeing mission. And this is something that I hope that we can work out and reach agreement on.
And Chair, just real quick, I think I brought this issue up first only because of what I saw as cutting into 4 or 5 feet of ledge. I had no intentions of requiring landscaping, such. I just want to make sure that the ledge was treated well, and that it was not jagged. We may look back in the record under Dyer Pond. We had an issue there, and I can't mention which lot it was. We required treatment. I think our Stone Gate may have had some ledge treatment. It's just very simple. It's not left in a ragged.
And I think I responded last meeting that we will probably, if there are 3 or 4 feet showing, that we would put a rock wall in the front of it and then put in some shrubs or some flowers, roses, or something, and kind of, you know, diminish that effect. And I really hope that we can keep to that.
Just so no one's confused as I may be with that comment, Steve, is your concern that the ledge not be left in a blasted condition, that is, that there's a lot of rubble and debris left around? Have any problem with the fact that someone's blasted ledge and there's a clean face of ledge there, do you?
No, not at all.
Okay.
No, I'm not asking for painting or anything.
That's another issue. Unfortunately, and another reason we want to get this thing moving along, Madam Chair, is We had a weenie roast or something down there at 4 o'clock. I think all the fire department was there, putting out a fire in the center of the subdivision. And we do not want to encourage defacing of the ledge by painting and stuff, which is another reason why we don't want to have that nice blackboard for the kids.
With that, I think we have concluded, at least from the board, all our comments, and I would like to, we have a full plate still ahead of us. So if I could have a motion from the board with respect to this, unless someone else has another burning but short comment. Ms. McKay.
I move that be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Joseph Frustacci for minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Rosewood, a 5-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Woodland Road and Mitchell Road, is tabled with the mutual consent of the applicant. Be tabled with the mutual consent of the applicant.
I have a second.
Second.
All those in favor, raise your right hands.
I have a question. Is there any need to refer directly to a public hearing at the next meeting?
I'm sorry, I would like to include that as my last sentence, that a public hearing is scheduled for the regular June 1992 meeting of the Planning Board.
Very good.
Second again.
As amended. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Against? It's passed unanimously. Let's set quickly a sidewalk date. Saturday mornings? Those always appeal to me, but I can do them at night.
I'll have to check my baseball schedule. So.
Oh, geez. You're supposed to have it all written in your book already, all the way up through August.
I do, but I didn't bring it this evening.
Do we want to tentatively set one? Or do you really are serious that you really don't dare set one right now?
No, someone will be there. I will be there. We can work it. And we should do it soon because of the the engineer's reports and the magnitude of the problem.
Next, this coming weekend's Memorial Weekend. A lot of people are going to be away there, I think. How about Saturday the 30th?
When do we have to resubmit information to the board for their consideration?
I think they give them less than a week.
That would be beyond.
Yeah, because it's the 16th is the meeting. Mm.
I would prefer to do it this Saturday, if it's at all possible.
Yeah. I'm going to be in Utah, so.
Okay.
I won't be here, but. Is there a weeknight?
A weeknight.
That's fine with me. Let's see. Monday, Tuesday?
Alternate Tuesday, that's not a plan.
Tuesday the 27th would be one of our, that's the...
My Tuesday comes on the 26th.
Yeah.
Well...
Picky.
The 26th. I was going to say, that's a Planning Board one, anyway. Tuesday the 26th, or Wednesday the 27th?
Tuesday would be better for me.
Be better for you? Okay, I still won't be able to attend that one.
I won't either, but I can do a drive-by and a walk-through.
I'll be out of town for a while.
Oh, heavens.
No, but I'll be out of town for a while, so it's not going to make any difference.
How about Wednesday? We do it Wednesday?
Sure, let's do it Wednesday.
I really want to go to
Wednesday's fine with me.
Let's do it. All right.
Done. Six?
Wednesday the 27th, we're in.
What time?
5:45. At the culvert.
We might be starting a tradition, watch it.
First annual sidewalk.